I have such a heart for Catholics because I have had a lot of friends who were Catholic, and to be honest with you, a lot of them were Catholic because of tradition. Their grandmother raised them Catholic, their mothers were Catholic, and even though they didn't honor that faith, they honored their grandparents. And that can be a very, very dangerous thing because people can lead you anywhere. And it will all lead you to death if we're not first following Jesus. Now, Catholics, in my experience, recognize Jesus as the Son of God. But when Jesus was giving the sermon, Mary actually came to visit him with her sons. And when they came to visit Jesus, they couldn't get in to see him because there was such a huge crowd around him. And so they told him, "Hey, Jesus, your mother and your brothers are here to see you." And he said, "Who are my mother and my brothers?" And he looks around at the multitude that's listening to him and taking in every word that he's saying. And he says, "My mother and my brother and my sisters are those who hear the will of God and do it." So if Jesus did not follow Mary, why are you following Mary? Just think about that. Mary cannot give you and has not given you the Holy Spirit. Mary did not even give you Jesus. She was the vessel that God used to birth him into this world. But he is the Son of God. So if you're gonna worship a parent of Jesus, worship his Father, who he has always led you to, and he has never led you to Mary. If God didn't use Mary, he would have chosen another vessel. I have many times in my walk with Christ backslidden or just not been in position to receive the thing that God was setting me up to receive. And because of my faltering, he's chosen someone else. He will always choose someone else because his will be done. And whether or not you want to be a part of it, that's your choice. But his will is going to go forth. And so if Mary was not in position, he would have chosen someone else. She was a vessel. But it is his will that will be done with or without a particular vessel. If you were sick and I had medicine to heal you, and I poured that medicine into a bottle, you would drink from that bottle and receive the medicine. If that bottle had a crack in it, and I realized I couldn't use it, and it's now rendered useless, I would find a cup, and I'd pour that medicine into a cup instead of a bottle. And that cup would be used to usher in the medicine to heal your body. What I'm telling you is, the vessel does a great job at ushering in what is needed, but it is not the medicine itself. It is not the cure itself. And it would be insane if the person who was healed took that cup and ran throughout the city saying, "This cup has healed me." And if they did that and passed that cup around to everyone who was sick, it wouldn't matter what they poured into that cup and drank from that cup. They would not receive healing because the healing was never in the vessel. The power was never in the vessel. It was in what the vessel was carrying. And as for the person who ran throughout the city, telling everyone that she was healed, the only way that she'd be able to receive any type of accreditation is if she pointed the sick to the physician. Because the physician can deliver more medicine to everyone. If she ran throughout the city and said, "I was healed, worship me," no one would get healed. I pray in the name of Jesus that something is unlocking in the spirit. Mary's gifts will be given of God because we store our treasures in heaven as the word of God that you believe says. We don't have to give her anything. She has no power in our lives. And if you could speak to her, because you can't, because she's dead, and she has not been resurrected, she would point you to Jesus. Do you understand that the apostles ripped their clothing and ran around screaming because people were worshiping them and not Jesus? And they were saying, it's not us who healed. We're just men just like you. It's Jesus. They ripped their clothing in just anguish because they were like, no, dude, it's not about me. I'm pointing you to Jesus. Don't worship me. I'm just a vessel. I'm a piece of paper with a message on it, but I'm not the message. I'm not the way. Jesus is the way. And yet we have the Catholic Church misleading people into believing that they are a denomination of Christianity. And I'm not even going to get into denominations, but that's absolutely false. Why would the apostles rip their clothing and mourn at the idea that someone was worshiping them and giving them glory instead of God if they were to be worshiped, if they were to be prayed to? Are we really grabbing these beads and going one by one saying different prayers to the saints? Huh? Where does God speak of the rosary? A man spoke of the rosary. A man named Dominic, who was not led by the Holy Spirit, but was deceived by demons, leading so many people astray. But the word of God tells us that Jesus is the way, the only way to God. I've heard so many people say there are different ways. No, the only way to the Father is through the Son. We sinned against God and we chose our Father. And that was the prince of this world. And God bought us back on that cross. Come on. On that cross. Why is it that so many people are seeking God today? People want to know God. They want to know, like, they want to know the truth. And this same world that is looking for God in everything is rejecting Jesus. And Jesus is the only one they're rejecting. You can sit and talk to someone about Buddhism for hours and they'll listen and smile and nod their head at everything you say. You can give them Buddhist proverbs and talk about peace, which is falsehood, and they will sit there and eat it up. All your New Age practices, your yoga. Come on. You can sit there and talk about Allah and Muhammad all day and people would just honor the fact that that's your belief. But when you mention the name of Jesus, people run away and their demons manifest. Why is it that your chest gets tight as an unbeliever when people talk about Jesus? Why do you feel that heaviness in your chest? Why does your heart start beating fast and you just want to end the conversation? Why does your mind go to a million different places when people talk about Jesus? But when people talk about anything else, you can sit there and focus. Those demons inside of you are manifesting because they do not want to hear the truth. Because if you hear it, you will believe. You will be saved, and they will have to go, and they will have failed their mission. And their assignment, which is to you specifically. So I just really, I'm saying this out of a place of pure compassion and urgency, because dude, this world is quite literally burning right now. In the spirit and in the natural, this world is burning. And we can't rely
on officials. I'm talking politically right now. I'm just trying to watch my words because things get banned. We cannot rely on those who are positioned in places of authority over our states, over our countries, over our judicial system, over our economic system. We can't trust any of them. We are seeing day after day how they are deceiving us, and God is exposing these things, and we're choosing, selectively choosing to ignore it. So we are in a place, in a time right now, where I'm trying to sound the alarm. We're trying to sound the alarm. Let me tell you what the Word of God says. That at the name of Jesus, at the return of Jesus Christ, every knee shall bow. And do you know what it says? It says every knee on earth and the heavens and below the earth shall bow. So at that moment, the demons that manifest when you try, when people are trying to share the gospel with you and you can't, and you just can't receive it, you can't listen, and you just start freaking out, those same demons who try to distract you from the gospel of Christ will be bowing. Okay, so there will be no distraction. There will be no confusion because darkness will bow. Satan will bow. Leviathan, Jezebel, every demonic spirit of pride and self-glorification and doubt will bow, will fall to its knees, and there will be no wall of defense. There will be no line of defense for you or for any demon. And so the reason why I'm sounding the alarm right now is because that time is going to come. And I'm going to tell you something. I'm going to be real brief about this. I was just explaining to a sister yesterday. I have had dreams about the coming of Christ. And at the time when I was having the dream, I was not living right. I knew the gospel. I believed it, but I did not live in accordance with the Word of God at all. I just was doing whatever I wanted to do. I was in sin. It was terrible. And so when I had that dream and I wasn't in right standing with God, I'm telling you, yo, it was just a dream, but I was freaking out when I woke up, and I was freaking out in the dream. Nothing mattered. I'm telling you, because you won't understand it until you experience it. And I don't want that for you. I don't want that for anyone, but I'm telling you, dude, nothing mattered. And I had never experienced nothing mattering to me. I was a very, very sensitive person at that time. I felt everything. I was very empathetic. I couldn't hear a story about a dog dying or about any. I couldn't hear anything because I would feel it myself. I felt a lot. My mind was always filled with thoughts of everyone around me, with concerns of everyone around me. And in that dream, when Jesus returned and I was not ready, I'm here to tell you, nothing else mattered. I didn't think about babies. I didn't think about my parents. I didn't think about my cousins. I didn't think about my family. I didn't think about anyone. The only thing that was real to me in that moment was Christ and my lack of salvation. Hear me. Was Christ in my lack of salvation? Woo! And in that dream, I was like trying to figure out how to fix things and and it was too late. And I was so, like, I was so relieved to have woken up and to know that that was just a dream. But I still did not feel peace because I knew that something must be done. Y que tenemos che. Something must have been, bro. I'm telling you, if you've ever experienced an earthquake in the middle of nowhere, it's like you might be having fun with your friends. You may be doing whatever you're doing. You may be spending time with your family. And as soon as that earth shakes, your first thought, let's not lie, is not to save the dog and not to grab the babies and not where's my wife or where's my husband and where's my mommy and daddy.
Your first thought is, oh, I'm gonna die. This is it. Like, your first thought, and I'm telling you right now, even that is nothing compared to, even in a dream, what it was like for Christ to return and I didn't have him. Let me just explain that. Let me just clarify that. But even in those moments where you think you're going to get in a car crash, or when you're in an Uber or on a bus and then the brake just, and the whole car or the whole vehicle just comes to a halt, even that is nothing to be compared. But because we can all relate to it, I'll use it. In that moment, all that's there is the reality that I really don't know what's about to happen. It feels in this second like I'm going to die, and I don't know where I'm going. Things like that happen and people go, Jesus! Who don't believe. Things like that happen and people go, God! And they don't even believe. Because you know in that moment that there's no phone call you can make. I've been in a car accident, and in that, it's like a second of time. You kind of realize what's going on, and then you realize you have no control. That's what happens. So you can't pick up the phone and call your best friend, and you can't grab your rosary, and you can't do any of that. You have to already know the Lord. Because for Christians, to die is gain. This shell, this body is gone. That means I'm going with Jesus, bro. I'm out of here. Let's go. I'm not in a rush, but you know what I'm saying? Whenever the Lord decides, I'm going to be with Jesus. Do you hear me? Paul said to live is Christ and to die is gain. Dude, if I'm out of here, I'm going to be with my Savior forever. That's where I want to be. While I'm here, I'm going to do his work. And he has a purpose for my life. And that's why when the Lord returns, as we all say, the word of God says it will be a great and terrible day. It will be a terrible day for people who never believed, who don't have salvation. That, by the way, is free and it's for everybody. Christ died for unbelievers. Christ died for sinners. For you who don't believe, it will be terrible. But for those who know and believe the gospel, it will be great. What side do you want to be on when he comes back? If it's a choice for you, make the choice. If it's a gamble for you, take the gamble. You need Jesus. You have free will. I'm not here to tell you that. You know that. You use it every day. I'm here to tell you to choose Jesus. I'm here to tell you to try Jesus. I'm here to tell you to say one prayer to Jesus Christ, to say one prayer to the Father in Jesus' name. Father, I come to you in Jesus' name. I really don't know if this is real or not. I just want to see. That's the end of my prayer. And then that's it. I just try the Lord. Some people are not going to want to hear that, but I ain't worried about them people. I'm concerned about you. Hell is a real place where you will never be able to die, but you also won't be able to breathe. Hell will be thrown into the lake of fire. All of hell will be thrown into the lake of fire. All the demons, all the unbelievers, all the Satanists, Satan himself. There will be weeping constantly, never ending. Never ending. There will be gnashing of teeth. I don't even know what that sounds like, but if I try to do it myself, it sounds terrible. I can't even do it. And there will be groanings. Ugh. It is not a party where all the rappers go, where Beyonce performs and Lil Nas X performs
and Travis Scott performs and we all dance around and we just getting drunk and getting high, that's not hell. They're lying to you. That's not what it is. They might be deceived themselves, but they're not telling you the truth. Hell is a very real place, and the Pope is leading many people there. Whether he knows it or it's unbeknownst to him, I don't know, but he's leading people there. The rabbi, whatever. I'm here to tell you, if they're not operating in the Holy Spirit of God, in God's Holy Spirit, if they're not coming in the name of Jesus Christ and doing the will of the Father, they're misleading you to a place that no one can get out of. The Bible says there is a chasm fixed between heaven and hell that no one can pass through. It is a great chasm that literally it is impossible for anyone to pass through. So whichever one your soul ends up in, you will have to stay there for all of eternity. If that doesn't sound realistic to you, you go ahead and try to leave Earth alive. You try to just go to another planet. Just touch the sky right now. You see how you're limited? You see how you're limited? Even having free will? Even having the choice to be able to receive Christ? Now imagine not being able to receive Christ because you're now in hell. Now try to touch the sky. You can't. Try to touch heaven. Try to repent, which is to turn away from your sins in the ways that you know are wicked, that the Bible tells you are wicked. Try. In hell, you can't. It's eternal. It's forever. And I know we use that word so loosely, so it's kind of lost a little bit of its sting. But truth be told, we've never seen forever, ever before. We've never seen it. We don't know what it looks like. We know what 20 years looks like. We know what 15 years looks like. We know what 30 years looks like. We know what 50 years looks like. And that seems like an eternity, but it's not, because eternity is timeless. If someone tells you 50 years from now, this will happen, then you can be sure that on the 50th year, this is going to happen. But eternity is endless. It's endless. I just hope that this reaches someone. I'm serious. You see Christians are doing this stuff every day, posting stuff and talking and standing outside and jumping on tables and interrupting people walking off of the airplane, and like, we're here to interrupt your life for sure. Yeah, we're gonna do that, because let me tell you something. The reason why we're doing it and nobody else is doing it is because nobody else cares and nobody else has the way. We have the way. Our God has the keys to hell. We don't have to go. That's what we're saved from. Like, we're saved from the bondage of darkness. How many times do you say, man, I have a lot of pride. I don't want to be like that. I'm really mean. I don't want to be like that. Wow, I'm really sad and really depressed. I don't want to be like that. Man, I'm really hurt in this area. I don't want to be like that anymore. Man, I curse a lot. I don't want to do that anymore. And you can't stop it. You're in chains. Anyone who is in sin is a slave to it. Jesus says that. But he has the keys so that we are no longer in bondage. And we will never experience hell. Whatever the earth has to offer while we're alive is the darkest it's going to get for us. Oof. But the darkness of hell? There is no light. There is no light. For real. There's no sun. God gives us breath. God gives us life. None of that is there. Jesus is the light of this world. So where's your light in hell? Where are your smiles in hell? Where are your friendships in hell? You know how many people go to prison? The one thing that I've heard people who have been to prison, people who have been to jail say, they all say, nobody writes you. All the people, like, that have, yo, free my homie in their bio and all that, like, they don't write them, they don't visit, they forget all about them. And they realize in prison that none of those people were really down for them. So you think, if that's happening on earth, do you think in hell, y'all just gonna be kicking it and having fun? And no, it's not, it's a lie, it's a lie. And Satan is destined to go there. That's inevitable. He cannot be saved, nor does he want to be. Every rape on this earth, every killing on this earth, though people blame God, is Satan's fault. He is the author of lies and deception and wickedness and pride. The word of God says we wrestle not against flesh and blood. And when it speaks of wickedness, it says, but we wrestle against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wickedness. That's what we're wrestling against. That is the power of darkness. That is the power of Satan. Wicked. And we have been chained to this stuff. And God has the keys. You can be saved. He can't. You can. Hear the word of the Lord today. Read the word of the Lord today. I love y'all. I really don't have anything else to say. I just pray in the mighty name of Jesus that whoever is listening will have the scales removed from their eyes, will have a change in their heart, will encounter Jesus, and will have a heart of repentance, will come to Christ in the mighty name of Jesus. I love y'all. I'm out.